The next step to understanding whether or not a molecule is polar or nonpolar is to understand everything we can about the molecule's shape. And to do that, we use a technique called valence shell electron pair repulsion, or VSEPR. The easiest way to start with VSEPR is to ask yourself, how many things are located around the central atom? Things can include electron pairs as well as bonded atoms. In the case of HCN, if we look at the central atom, we see that there are two things bonded to that central atom, the hydrogen and the nitrogen. So that would count as two things. For SO2, we see that there are actually three things around the central atom. There are two atoms and a lone pair, and so that counts as three things. In the case of water, we see that there are two atoms, two hydrogens, and two lone pairs. That counts as four things around the central atom. The next question you should ask yourself is, how can I arrange these things around the central atom so that they are as far apart as possible from each other? Before we start to answer this question, let's go over some terms. First, the steric number. This is the number of things, that is, electrons and bonded atoms around the central atom. Next, the geometry is referred to as the arrangement of the things around the central atom. The shape, sometimes called the molecular shape, is the arrangement of the bonded atoms around the central atom. This does not include the electron pairs. Finally, the bond angle is the angle formed between two bonded atoms with the central atom at the vertex. If we were to measure the bond angle of a water molecule, we would be considering the HOH bond angle. That is to say, the angle that is formed between the connection of the two hydrogens with the oxygen atom. And this would be called the HOH bond angle. And in that case, the oxygen is the atom that is at the vertex. So what happens when you have two things around the central atom? In this case, where the steric number would be two, we have one way in which we can get the two things as far away from each other as possible. And that way is to put them directly across from each other. So geometrically, we would call this a linear geometry. Since the geometry is linear, the bond angle that is formed between the hydrogen, carbon, and the nitrogen in this example is going to be 180 degrees. So that's a 180 degree bond angle. Also, since we don't have any lone electron pairs on the carbon, the central atom in this case, the shape of this molecule is also linear. In the case where we have three things around a central atom, in other words, the steric number is three, there are two possibilities in this case. We could either have, as is shown with SO2, we could either have two bonded atoms and a lone pair, or we could have three bonded atoms around the central atom. In either case, we are going to arrange these three things around the central atom in a roughly 120 degree bond angle. In the case of BF3, we have three identical atoms bonded to the boron. And so that's going to result in a bond angle here of 120 degrees. And that bond angle will be the same between all three of these atoms. When this happens, we have a geometry that we call trigonal planar. The shape of this molecule is also trigonal planar. In the case of sulfur dioxide, we have two bonded oxygens and one lone pair around the central atom. The two bonded oxygens are going to create an angle with the sulfur that is just a little bit less than 120 degrees. The reason the angle is a little bit less than 120 degrees is because the electron pair takes up a lot of space and has a lot of influence on the angle by pushing the oxygen atoms together. So the bond angle in SO2 might be somewhere around 118 degrees or so. Sulfur dioxide is going to have the same geometry as every other molecule that has a steric number of 3. It's going to have trigonal planar geometry. But sulfur dioxide only has 2 atoms around a central atom instead of 3. And so when we talk about the shape of sulfur dioxide, we can say that it is bent rather than trigonal planar. Because when we consider the shape, we don't consider the electron pairs. So we only look at the bonded atoms. And if you look at sulfur dioxide and you don't consider the electron pairs, then it looks bent. In both of these cases, the geometry of the molecules is trigonal planar, which means that the molecules themselves exist in a planar conformation. That is to say, these molecules are flat, kind of like a piece of paper. In the case where we have 4 things around a central atom, things get a little bit more complicated. These molecules are not planar. That is to say, they exist in a 3-dimensional space rather than a 2-dimensional space, so they're not flat like a piece of paper. In the case of methane, CH4, the molecule is not flat. It is instead more like a tripod where you have a hydrogen at each corner. Due to the 3-dimensional structure of methane, the bond angle between the carbon and the hydrogens is not 90 degrees, like it looks like it would be if you drew it on a piece of paper. Instead, this bond angle is about 109.5 degrees. Methane has a geometry that we call tetrahedral, and a shape that is also tetrahedral. The ammonia molecule, NH3, has a lone pair in one of the positions. It is not flat either. It is also a 3-dimensional molecule, and it has a bond angle just less than 109.5. It has a bond angle of about 107 degrees. Ammonia, because it still does have 4 things around the central atom, has a geometry that is tetrahedral. The shape of ammonia is called trigonal pyramidal. And this is because we do not look at or consider the electron pair that we have drawn in the top position of this molecule. And so because of this, it looks like a 3-sided pyramid. In the case of the water molecule, we have 2 bonded atoms and 2 lone pairs around the oxygen. And since we still have 4 things around the central atom, the geometry is going to be tetrahedral, and the electron pairs are going to have a subtle effect on the bond angle, and they're going to decrease it by about 5 degrees as compared to methane. So the bond angle for the HOH in the water molecule is going to be about 104.5 degrees. Now, because water is tetrahedral, and we don't count the presence of the lone pairs when we look at the shape, all we see is the HOH, And so we call that shape bent. When there are five things around a central atom, the process gets even more complicated. In this case, we have two areas where we can put things. And to illustrate that, I'm going to draw phosphorus pentachloride. And I'm going to show you that we have actually two positions. We have what are called axial positions, and we have equatorial positions. And so these two positions are going to be shown here. You have the phosphorus in the middle, you have chlorine on the side, you have these other two chlorines on this side. Now these three chlorines at the end of the pointer are all in the same plane, and we call those equatorial, like as in equator. The other two chlorines, the ones on the top and on the bottom, those are not in the same plane as the ones around the middle, and so we call that the axial position. And so there are actually two positions where the atoms can go on something that has five things around a central atom. So when we talk about where we're going to put electron pairs or where we're going to put atoms, and we say the words equatorial and axial, that's what those positions refer to. Now, in the case of phosphorus pentachloride, all five positions are occupied by the chlorine, so there's no difference in where we're going to put things. But the bond angles between these positions are interesting. And so this one right here is a 90-degree bond angle. That's between the chlorines in the equatorial plane and the chlorine in the axial plane. Those are 90-degree bond angles. The bond angles between the chlorines within the equatorial plane, those bond angles are 120 degrees. Okay, so there are three of those chlorines, and they are all 120 degrees apart. So the bond angles are either 90, if you're talking about an axial position relative to an equatorial position, or they're 120 degrees if all of the atoms are in the equatorial position. The geometry of phosphorus pentachloride is called trigonal bipyramidal, and the shape has the same name in this case. The shape refers to a trigonal pyramid where you have the top of the pyramid on top and another pyramid on the bottom. So it's kind of like putting two pyramids base to base so that one points at the top and one points toward the bottom. In the case where you have four bonded atoms and a lone pair, the question becomes, where do you put the lone pair? Do you put the lone pair in an axial position, or do you put it in an equatorial position? As with always, when we choose where we're going to put things, we want to get the greatest separation of charges as we can around the central atom. And so it turns out that the greatest separation of charge happens when the electron pair is in the equatorial position. So this one right here is the correct answer. And the reason for that is because what that does is it gives you a electron pair that is 90 degrees from two atoms and 120 degrees from the other two atoms. And in the case where we have the electron pair in the axial position, we are 90 degrees away from three fluorines. And so in the equatorial position, we are 90 degrees from only two fluorines. And so being 90 degrees away from two fluorines is better than being 90 degrees away from three fluorines. As before, the presence of the electron pair does have an effect on the bond angle. And so as a result, the bond angle between the axial and equatorial position decreases a little bit. So where it was 90 degrees, now it's somewhere around 88, 89 degrees. And the bond angle here between the two equatorial, between the two axial positions now decreases from being about 180 degrees to being maybe about 178 degrees. The geometry for this molecule is going to be trigonal bipyramidal because it does have five groups around the central atom. And the shape is called seesaw. And that shape comes from, if you were to turn this molecule on its side, you could draw something that looks like a teeter-totter. And so that shape is called seesaw after the teeter-totter. In the case of ClF3, we have three bonded atoms and two electron pairs. As before, we're going to put the electron pairs in the equatorial position because that's how the molecule is going to be most stable. And the bond angles that we're going to get from that are going to be a little bit less than 90 degrees here to here. So this is going to be about 87 to 88 degrees. The shape of this one is going to be called T-shaped. And that is because you can see how the molecule makes a T if you draw it like this, where you have the fluorines to the side and one on the bottom. You can see that it makes a T. The geometry of this one is, again, trigonal bipyramidal. In the case where we have six things around a central atom, all six bond angles are going to be 90 degrees. And so these bond angles right here are going to be the same on all of the fluorines. And this geometry in this case is called octahedral. And the shape is also octahedral. In the case of IF5, we have five bonded fluorines and one lone pair of electrons. It doesn't make any difference where you put the lone pair. All the positions are equivalent in the octahedral geometry. The electron pair is going to compress the molecule slightly, so the bond angles between the fluorines are going to decrease by about a couple of degrees. So instead of being 90 degrees, this bond angle might be about 88 degrees or so. And we call this one square pyramidal. So this one is square pyramidal. And the geometry is, once again, octahedral. In the case of XeF4, we have two lone pairs of electrons. When we put these two lone pairs of electrons in this molecule, it doesn't matter where we put them, as long as we put them directly across from each other, because the lone pairs are going to want to get as far away from each other as they possibly can. So we're going to put them either in one of the two positions on each side of the molecule or on the top and bottom. However you draw it, it doesn't make any difference as long as they are not next to each other. Now, this is going to cause the bond angles here to be back to what they were before, which was 90 degrees. And the way I've drawn this molecule may not look like 90 degrees, but this molecule now is actually planar. It is flat, okay? So when we look at the electron pairs, it has a geometry that is octahedral. However, its shape is called square planar.